This is the panel on video essays. And first, I'm just going to ask our wonderful panelists, those who are here, to give us introductions. We'll start with Sheila. Sheila O'Malley, please tell us briefly about yourself.
I was recently, Roger recently hired me to write reviews for RogerEbert.com. I have my own site. I write for Capital New York, film coverage in New York City. And that's okay. Why I'm here.
Fantastic. How about Steve Boone, just in time?
Hey. I'm Steve Boone. I'm a film critic. Written for various places, including RogerEbert.com. And I do video essays on my own most of the time, but sometimes people pay me to do some.
That's a good deal. Good Dr. Bordwell.
Hi, I'm David Bordwell. I'm retired from teaching at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. I used to teach film history and aesthetics, and now I write a blog, and with the assistance of my filmmaker friend, Eric Gunnison, make quasi-video essays, I'd say.
Okay, fantastic. And Kevin.
Hi, I'm Kevin Lee. I'm a film critic and filmmaker based in Chicago, and I've produced several video essays primarily for IndieWire, Press Play, and Fandor.
Excellent. Pablo.
Good morning. My name is Pablo Vilas. I'm a film critic and a writer from Brazil. I've been a correspondent of Rogers for 3 years now, and I have no idea what I'm doing here.
Sounds great.
That makes two of us.
I'm Patrick Wayne, the director of In the Family, and I think I'm here to help set the record for panelists.
This is the Patrick Fest. Grace, no relation to Patrick.
None whatsoever. My name is Grace Wong. I'm based in Toronto. I'm a writer, filmmaker, and producer, and I've also worked for film festivals in the past.
Fantastic. And Krishna.
Hi, I'm Krishna. I'm from Bangalore in India. I'm a film student, and I'm one of Roger's correspondents. Good. I'm just here to enjoy the movies.
Fantastic. Let's jump right into the discussion. So we're speaking about video essays, and Dr. Bordwell, I'd like you to tell us, what are video essays? My students, if they hear video, they would say thumbs up, but if they hear essay, thumbs down. So please tell us.
Well, I think it's a sort of an ill-defined genre. You know that essays in literary writing are essentially think pieces, distinct from reportage and factual reporting on the one hand and sort of deep academic treatises on the other, sort of in the middle, opinion pieces where you're free to meditate. And there's something always tentative and inviting about, I think, literary essays from the source of the term, one tends to use essay, meaning an attempt or try. And a way in which that's gotten transposed into other domains, like photo essays and photojournalism of the 1950s, and then eventually video essays, have been along those lines of saying, here are some thoughts, here are some ideas. We're meditating and reflecting on something. It may have an argument, a well-structured argument, or it may have something that's more associative and more sort of wandering or meandering. But it's always an effort, I think, to engage people with ideas and the writer's own personal take on those ideas.
Mm-hmm. So the focus, there is not a specific set of rules for the video essay.
I don't think so. I think you can consider, say, Michael Moore's films in a way, essayistic, op-ed pieces, as he calls them. But at the other hand, you can have very, very free-form essays.
Okay. All right, so it's a very, very big genre.
Yep.
Kevin, you have a clip for us.
Right, so this is from the video essay accompaniments to the newest edition of David Bordwell and Kristen Thompson's indispensable textbook, Film Art and Introduction. And these video essays are co-produced with the help of the Criterion Collection. Right? Mm-hmm. So we're going to show one that's exploring the art of editing. And I have to apologize to all the panelists in advance due to the length and the number of panelists. We're just going to show 2 minutes of each person's work. So, and hopefully that's an encouragement for all of you to go online, which is where all of these videos reside, free. And watch the complete versions of the videos online.
Free is a good word.
Yeah.
You're the filmmaker. You've decided to break up a scene into separate shots. So how will you make sure the viewer knows where everything is located in the scene space? If we see one character in one shot, then another character in the next shot, viewers will need to understand where each one is located. Over the history of film, one common solution involves what's called analytical editing. Here, the filmmaker provides an overall view, often called an establishing shot. That shows us all the important areas of the space. Usually, that means showing where the characters are in relation to one another. Then the filmmaker can cut to closer views of parts of the space, fairly confident that the viewer will remember where characters are when they aren't on screen. This progression from an establishing shot to portions of the space is called analytical, because the overall space is broken down or analyzed into parts. Our sample scene from The Maltese Falcon in Chapter 6 of Film Art shows this process at work. When Bridget O'Shaughnessy comes into Sam Spade's office, we see her first from behind Spade's shoulder. Then, as she moves to the desk and takes her seat, her action prompts director John Huston to provide a wider, establishing shot. Once we understand where she and Spade are located, Huston can analyze the space into closer shots of each one. Note that Huston employs over-the-shoulder framings that also remind us of the other character's presence. In the course of analytical editing, the filmmaker can vary the scale of the shots to emphasize reactions more clearly. In our chapter, we point out several cues that remind us where characters are, even if they're off-screen. The most basic is the 180-degree principle, which always keeps us on one side of the action. The 180-degree system allows directors to use characters' eyes to reconfirm characters' locations. This is the technique of the eyeline match. Cutting to something that is being looked at by one character tells us that the off-screen character is still where we assume he or she is. Analytical editing can get more complicated when you have several characters in the locale, so directors are usually careful to make positions and eyelines consistent in each shot. See our Connect extract on Shaun of the Dead for examples of how this is done.
Okay, so in this clip we find analysis, and it seems to me that this is a perfect evolution in the process of writing about film, about teaching about film, right? That rather than have the written word, we have video with commentary. I want you to bring some attention to Matt Seitz, who's done some excellent work on many subjects, but you also have something big coming out on Wes Anderson. Why don't you just briefly introduce yourself to everyone and then tell us about your Wes Anderson essays.
My name is Matt Zoller Seitz. I'm currently a television critic for New York Magazine, and I've written for a bunch of different outlets. And about 5 years ago, I started making video essays after doing a few with my friend Kevin. And I work in a wide variety of formats, and we'll get into the details of that, I guess, as the panel goes on. But what we're about to see here is an excerpt from this five-part series that I did on Wes Anderson, the films of Wes Anderson, who directed The Royal Tenenbaums, Fantastic Mr. Fox, Moonrise Kingdom, and other movies. And the first two explored specific stylistic things that he took from other directors, from studying other directors like Truffaut, Martin Scorsese, and so forth. And the third one was an extended comparison of him with the filmmaker Hal Ashby. The fourth one was about the effect of J.D. Salinger on the stories that he told. And the finale is this, which we're going to see a piece of, which is I played the prologue to Royal Tenenbaums, and I just did margin notes text. Now, I should give you a caveat, which is that this is not necessarily intended to be watched in real time. You know, the text, there's so much text on screen at the top and the bottom. I use he shoots in CinemaScope format, and I letterboxed it in the middle of the frame, and then I use the black space above and below to write my captions. So this text, there's so much of this text, and sometimes there's two different thoughts being expressed at the top and the bottom of the page, but it's intended to be freeze-framed. So, you know, you can, as you're watching it, you can pause it, read it, keep going, you know, watch the clip, and then go back and watch it again, pausing it. That's sort of how it's intended to be watched. But this will at least give you a flavor.
Royal Tenenbaum bought the house on Archer Avenue in the winter of his 35th year. Over the next decade, he and his wife had three children, and then they separated.
Are you getting divorced?
At the moment, no. But it doesn't look good.
Do you still love us?
course I do.
Do you still love Mom?
Yes, very much, but your mother's asked me to leave, and I must respect her position on the matter.
Was that our fault?
No. Oh, obviously, we made certain sacrifices as a result of having children, but no, Lord, no.
Then why'd she ask you to leave?
I don't really know anymore. Maybe I wasn't as true to her as I could have been.
Well, she says...
Let's just drop it, shall we, Jazzy?
They were never legally divorced.
Thank you, Pavetta.
Etheline Tenenbaum kept the house and raised the children, and their education was her highest priority.
Yes, I'll hold, please. Thank you.
I need $187.
Write yourself a check. Bene, sì, grazie mille.
She wrote a book on the subject.
The gentleman in the blue cardigan, please.
Thank you. I have a two-part question.
Go ahead.
Chaz Tenenbaum had, since elementary school, taken most of his meals in his room, standing up at his desk with a cup of coffee to save time. In the sixth grade, he went into business breeding Dalmatian mice, which he sold to a pet shop in Little Tokyo. He started buying real estate in his early teens and seemed to have an almost preternatural understanding of international finance. He negotiated the purchase of his father's summer house on Eagles Island.
Yes, wow. I see what you mean.
How long did it take for you to make this? A few hours?
That chapter, I don't know. Yeah, a few hours probably.
Seriously?
Yeah.
And this is almost like watching, just looking at a website.
Pretty much,
with all the hyperlinks.
Yeah. That's the idea. Well, and actually, Kevin, the series that Kevin and I have worked on together, and we've done quite a few of them together, he has a slang term for this sort of thing, this kind of annotation where you're throwing captions up on screen, drawing lines, circling things, and so forth. He calls it Monday night footballing. So that is kind of what this is. And this series, by the way, was a few months after it came out in spring of 2009, I got asked to turn it into a book. And the book is coming out in October. It's called The Wes Anderson Collection, and it's a book-length analysis of the style of Wes Anderson. So good. Look for that.
Shameless plug, but
plug
perfect.
Concluded.
But, I mean, your point is well taken that you to really get the most out of this, you have to pause, rewind. And in that sense, it's very specific to the web medium. And I think this is something that we have to bear in mind. Sort of like, what are the aesthetic possibilities that the online format allows us to exploit? And I think this video really exemplifies that.
Mm-hmm. Sheila, you're here covering for Jim Emerson, who couldn't make it. He sends his love to all of us. You have Who Should Win the Oscars. Tell us about video essays. What is a video essay to you?
Well, this one, I narrated a bunch of them for Press Play. So they were put together. They're really kind of elegant. Interesting clips from all of the nominees, and then there were essays written by different writers for Press Play, basically saying who should win, and sort of look at all of the nominees and then who should win. So we went into the studio in Brooklyn, and
Kingkiller Studios.
Yes, and I had to get all my pronunciations right of everybody's names, and. We, you know, recorded the voiceover, which is often a really important element of these video essays. We had to really time stuff because we knew clips we would want the moment. I couldn't just rush from sentence to sentence because there had to be a moment allowed for whatever was being described. They're very specific essays. This moment is good. Look for this moment. That's one of the things that I love about these video essays is they can really sort of you're zooming in on something.
And we should actually tie it into Roger, because I'm pretty sure that we got the idea for doing this from those wonderful Oscar specials that Siskel and Ebert used to do back in the 90s, you know, when they were in Disney World and they have the tuxedos on and they say who should win, and then he would show clips to support their argument for why so-and-so deserves to be best mm-hmm. asker.
Can we just take a parenthetical and say that this panel might very well not exist if it weren't for Roger, that Roger and Gene Siskel did right. on the television show, specifically those sections where they went beyond simply throwing up a clip and talking about it and actually analyze something. Like, they would do entire shows about particular subjects. They would do entire sections about particular directors. I think they did an entire episode about Spike Lee one time, the purpose of which was just to let everybody know how awesome Spike Lee was. And that's sort of the spirit in which this is conceived, this series for Press Play, which is my IndieWire website that I run with Ken Cancelosi.
All right, stick with it.
Pretty much all of this year's Best Supporting Actress nominees are great, although a puking, pooping Melissa McCarthy in Bridesmaids may not exactly be the stuff of Oscar dreams.
No, look away! Megan, no! Look away! Oh.
Berenice Bejo offers a charming modern take on a silent film ingenue-turned-star.
I'm looking for some help at my house.
Jessica Chastain especially can do no wrong as the help's Marilyn Monroe-style damsel in distress. And in that same film, Octavia Spencer offers a terrific study in subversion as a maid who won't toe the line.
Eat mush.
But it is Janet McTeer who should take this award.
Oh!
Albert Nobbs itself is nothing to write home about. Its depiction of a woman masquerading as a male servant feels as dated as the myth of the tragic mulatto. McTeer is so subtly wrought as Hubert, a lesbian passing as a male painter, that she redeems the film.
So, Mr. Nobbs, what do you suggest we do now?
Too bad that Hollywood loves to lavish accolades upon straight people who play gay or transgendered, but rarely rewards actors who remain mum about their sexuality, as McTeer has. Wry and doggedly watchful, hers is the sort of unobtrusively generous performance that should define this category.
So the recurring theme here is that the authors of these video essays are telling or teaching or guiding the viewer on how to watch the movie. Like, here are special points about the movie, or here are things to notice. That seems to be the recurring theme so far. Let me turn to Steve Boone, who does do-it-yourself, low-budget eye candy. Tell us about this.
So I was watching some of the work that Kevin and Matt were doing around that time, and I got intrigued. Like, let me see what I can do with this stuff. And I think this was probably the first video essay I did, and it was kind of an annotated thing in that style that Matt's talking about. But I was trying to figure out a way to analyze a sequence of a film where you can grasp every piece of the annotation and kind of make it almost part of the experience of watching the sequence. So I picked a film that I love, George Lucas's THX-1138. And the entire final chase sequence, which is about 9 minutes long, I just took the whole thing and annotated it to explain how Lucas, in contrast to the Lucas that we know today, with a limited budget, created an entire world, and how he did it shot by shot.
Did I get a hint that you like the Lucas of the past more than the Lucas of today?
That hint, yeah, it is pretty. Hint.
Okay, I just wanted to confirm. All right, let's take a look at the clip.
Into the internal module control pulse, a 9. Now, this is the 619, a brand new 6071. This logic network converts the buffered memory signals.
I have a vehicle entering a restricted access expressway. Vehicle is a Samos 3.
Oh,
have just exceeded your primary budget.
So this is interesting. The first two pieces that we saw focused on an almost academic explanation, an academic guide to the films. The last two have been sort of op-ed pieces, and yours has especially had a few opinions here, perhaps thinking about what has been lost through time. Pablo, tell us about your work.
Yeah, that's why I said at the beginning that I don't know what I'm doing here, because as I look at those video essays, they're so sophisticated in the way they present their ideas, and I don't know how to do them. I don't know if it was Truffaut who said that the best way of reviewing a film is by making another film, and that's what these guys are doing, and I don't know how to do that, because I don't know how to edit. What I do is very old school. I stand in front of my TV set.
What's a television? I've heard of those things.
Yeah. And I choose a film that I enjoy, and I try, because I think most people, they only see about 20% of the film they're watching. People pay attention to the story, not even the plot. They pay attention to the story and to the actors. And what I try to do, I teach a course on film language and film theory in Brazil, and now I'm teaching a second course that's based on Dr. Bordwell's writings. He was kind enough to let me discuss it with him. And what I try to do is to show the viewer, if they're feeling emotional about something, if they're laughing about something, if they're scared of something, there is a reason behind that, and that's the filmmaking craft. And I try to show them how, through not only the story and the actors, but through the editing, the cutting, the lighting, the set design, the costumes, and etc., how they achieve that effect. So I choose a film, I select a few scenes, and I discuss them in a very old school manner.
All right, let's take a look at old school.
And then I think Pablo's going to do a live demonstration.
It'll be just like a cooking show.
O marrom é uma cor específica, uma cor que vai passar uma ideia normalmente de tristeza, de introspecção, de sobriedade, que é o que ele é.
This
até que entra no filme a figura da Kim Novak. E já na entrada dela, a primeira posição dela no filme vai introduzir essa cor, aliás, não só essa cor, mas o verde, que é a cor marcante dela, mas dentro de um ambiente vermelho. O vermelho, ele de azul mais uma vez, né? O vermelho, ele tem uma série de significados. Se for na filmografia de Scorsese, a culpa católica, a gente já discutiu isso no videocast sobre os bons companheiros, mas o vermelho normalmente ele é associado com duas coisas, sexo, o amor,
So, sorry. I just want to point out that actually Matt and I did not, and others, we didn't know about these videos until this, and it was just like, it just opened up this whole other world.
Yeah.
It's like, because we're just so maybe locked into our own like kind of American film culture, and to see, and this is kind of what Roger was all about. It was like casting the net far and wide and discovering amazing work being done all over the world. And I mean, you have a tremendous following in Brazil, and and it's great that you're starting to put subtitles to these videos.
Actually, I put for this panel.
Well, I'll start somewhere.
So it's as I said, it's very old school, and I'm ashamed of myself because you can actually see the reflex of the camera on the TV because it's, but what the good news is now I'm discussing with some producers in Brazil so we can do a proper web series with, you know, proper lighting and proper editing. But there, actually, the first time I did the vertical thing, so you can see how amateur I am in doing them, it was very hot in Brazil. And I knew I was only going to show, you know, above the waist. So I recorded the video. I uploaded the video. And 1 minute later, the first comment on YouTube was, am I imagining things or you were not wearing any pants? Because I, when I step back, sometimes I step back to so the viewers can see the video, my reflex on the TV said. So maybe I will start a new series, I don't know, The Naked Critic. I will have my own version of the thumbs up.
And we'll all move.
What's most interesting about this is that Pablo, at the beginning of this comment, said he should be ashamed of being old school. Nothing about being ashamed about being half naked.
Oh, yeah. So, but the first comment, so I had time to, you know, take the video down, and it's, and then I re-recorded. So. But what I do in my classes and what I try to do in this video is I'm going to show you, actually Kevin's going to show you six scenes from a film that I truly love. And I wrote about this film for Ebert, for Roger Seid, which is Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. When it was released, everybody hated it. The audience, the critics, they still hate it. But I love this film. And well, we only have a couple minutes to show clips. So what I usually do is I present the clips, and I ask the students or the viewer to try to see if they can observe what I'm trying to say, and then I show them. But we don't have time. So what I want you to pay attention is to the camera position. We are going to see six scenes. Three of them deal with death. Two of them deal with the creation of life. And there is the sixth scene that you are going to see.
Come on!
It's no use, Victor. He's gone.
No, Henry.
Let him go.
No, this shouldn't happen.
Let him go.
But stop.
Help us.
Stop. Shut.
Victor.
Help us. It need not happen.
It's very operatic, very, you know, he loves showing himself with his shirt off and stuff, I know.
So
I recognize
I'm noticing
people.
A trend here.
Yeah.
Someone who likes to have their pants
That's
off.
That's why I love this one, yeah. But the thing is, it's very clear what he does. Every time he shows death in the film, he uses a very, very high angle camera. And when he's showing the creation of life, he uses a very, very low angle. And what I try to point to the students is, could that be coincidental? Of course not. Of course, it's a very rational, conscient decision. And he's trying to create a symbol, a metaphor, using his camera. And that's the thing that's so beautiful about movies. You can watch just 20% of the film, but if you see the other 80%, you not only get the emotions that the filmmaker is trying to create, but you also know how he's trying to do that. That doesn't detract from the emotion. I cry a lot at movies. I'm a cry baby. And sometimes I will cry, not because the film is emotional, but I will cry at the craft, at the skill of the filmmaker, like this. I really get emotional when I see that, because he's trying to create a metaphor. Now, what that metaphor is, that's up to discussion. I'm not going to tell you what he means. It could be when a person dies, there is this God point of view with the soul is going away, and when he's trying to create life, it's a hellish thing, so you're looking for him below. I don't know, but it's obvious that he's trying to do something. He's creating a symbol. And then there is this sixth thing, scene, and you see how perfect the metaphor is. Because you have death and birth in the same scene, so they balance each other out, the high angle and the low angle, so you have it's parallel to the ground. And that's just the beginning. I don't know if you noticed, but he plays with circles. In the five first scenes, at the end of the each scene, you have a circle enveloping the characters. You have the people, well, the fire forms a circle. You can see that there is a flammable fluid that makes the fire around the body. The theater in the first scene, the people around the body in the second scene. Of course, the circles between the corpses when he's creating the monster. So he's playing with circles. Again, what he means with that, it's a circle of life. It's I don't know, but it's, I mean, I have my own interpretation, but you can have yours. But it's a metaphor. And then, in the last scene, you have birth and you have death. And you have a clock. And at the clock, you have two circles. And this is beautiful. I mean, it's so well thought. When you notice those things, you see how much work, how much intelligence, how careful Kenneth Branagh was when he was making the film in creating symbols, and that's something that really moves me, and that's what I try to illustrate in my amateur naked videos.
Emotionally and intelligently naked.
Yeah.
So one thing we should point out about the video is that it demonstrates a very prevalent and very potent technique that has emerged with a lot of online videos, not just video essays, but just it's called the supercut technique, which is where you take different shots or different scenes from a film or several films, and you lay them out one next to the other so that a pattern emerges, and you notice a visual motif, or it could be a line of dialogue that you hear in different films or in the same film several times. And it's a very, very easy, very, very easy to understand and very powerful way just to get meaning across. Mm-hmm. Actually, Jon Stewart and Stephen Colbert, they both use it in their shows, The Daily Show, when they take, you know, conservative pundits all saying the same thing in different talk shows because they've all been fed the same lines, and it kind of exposes that in front of everyone. Mm. So,
wonderful. Let's shift gears. Patrick, you're on the other side. You're the filmmaker, and then Kevin Lee made a very increasingly popular essay. Tell us, how did you discover video essays, and why did you decide to incorporate one into your DVD?
Asian. It's it's very recently that I've discovered these folks, and it's really exciting to me. I think Kevin's were among the first I saw. And I may add a couple categories to the ones we've been talking about, which is I had on this on our release that's going to be counted, there's Kevin's wonderful essay. There's an essay by another filmmaker who used a very interesting style of mostly stills and some very small video loops as he discussed and recapped some of his experience and his experiences hosting Q&As and discussions about the film. And I've been so inspired that I actually wanted to create some video essays too. New Yorker, we had these conversations, we're like, what do you want to call these? Because it seems a little odd for a reflexive form to be called an essay. And I think in the end we called some of them essays. But I think that that's how exciting it is to me that I wanted to participate and kind of see what would come up too.
Okay.
And also promote the DVD, which comes out in June.
June 25th, yes.
I'll do that for you, Patrick.
So Kevin, tell us about this clip.
So basically I made a short video essay for Patrick's film, about Patrick's film, and it deals with issues about race and how we judge people on the surface level. I'll let the video first speak for itself.
Asian faces have long been a signpost of mystery and mistrust in American cinema. We can go as far back as Sessue Hayakawa as a devious sexual predator in The Cheat, made in 1915. Asian characters are more acceptable when they're less threatening, portrayed as comic caricatures. It's a dehumanizing trait that exists in Hollywood even today. In the Family plays with this long-standing perception of Asians as enigmatic, most notably by using a recurring visual motif of Joey seen from behind. In these shots, we can't see Joey's facial expressions. He is visually withheld from us, whether to create dramatic intrigue or to convey his character's emotional blankness in a state of grief. This technique also conveys a sense of how people project their thoughts and emotions upon him.
Welcome to Thanksgiving.
Yeah, Mama, he knows what Thanksgiving is.
Welcome to our Thanksgiving.
Yes, let's all thank Joey for coming down from outer space for Thanksgiving.
It's
okay.
But what's interesting about In the Family is that many of the white characters are depicted as equally, if not more, inscrutable.
What do you know? Finally get to meet face to face. Of course, a lot of great things about you. Not like you needed to. It's like our stomachs have known you for years.
Their performances are far more muted than what you find in most American films. At key points, they come off as cold, distant, whether due to bureaucratic insensitivity.
Eileen told me it was stable, but that was a little while ago. Do you know what's happening now?
Nurse Edwards will talk to you about that.
Okay.
Or personal distrust.
I also want to just pay tribute to Professor Boardwell, who's been the teacher of so many of us, by acknowledging his influence in the video work, because I talk a bit about what I consider to be a very generous approach towards space and time in this film. It really lets you just inhabit the same space as these characters, and so I do something that Professor Boardwell is quite famous for doing, which is just counting shots and lengths of scenes.
Say.
Weird.
Compare this to a film like Lincoln, a film that feels pretty slow-paced compared to most Hollywood dramas. Over the course of its 165-minute running time, In the Family has a total of 280 shots. Lincoln has 280 shots in just its first 50 minutes. Or compare In the Family to a stately European art film like Amour. The average length of each shot in Amour is 31.5 seconds. In the Family's average shot length is 36.3 seconds, almost 5 seconds longer than Amour. What this suggests is an uncommon insistence on immersing the viewer in an uninterrupted sense of space and time.
Anyway, so did you count all these shots?
Yeah.
And you timed
but,
every shot.
You know, I don't have the patience or the diligence of David, Professor Boardwell, who would sit with a movie and have a stopwatch and click and take notes. Because thanks to the power of, you know, nonlinear editing, you can just cut up a scene in the edit timetable and just sort of count it that way. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, so in some ways, you know, these techniques are easier to execute in the digital editing stage. Mm-hmm. And so these tools that we have are more available to us. And that's why I feel like this is a very democratic, not art form, but form of analysis where, you know, in theory, anyone has the access and the ability to do this.
So one of the benefits of this whole process of video essays, especially looking at these last two pieces, is that we begin to unlock the genius in many of these films. Like Pablo, you make this wonderful point that we only see 20% of the movie, and there's 80% of wonderful, wonderful imagery, wonderful craft. Which brings us to Krishna. Krishna, who gained a lot of fame in the past few months for a wonderful little video about his favorite director. Why don't you introduce the video to us, please?
I'm a huge fan of Steven Spielberg.
Who's Steven Spielberg?
He's made a few movies that no one's heard of. He's my hero. My mom introduced me to him when I was 8, and I've been watching his movies since then. And I wanted to get across why he was my hero. There were like so many reasons that, and writing about them, it just became a series of adjectives. So I wanted to express it in a way that got across exactly what I felt about him. Like, for example, he has such a variety of movies. So I used clips from jarringly different genres and put them back to back and try to flow them into each other. And then he has a way of, you know, using visuals and music together to have this impact, spectacle. So I try to sort of show all of those things. And
So this video is just as much about you as it is about Steven Spielberg.
Yeah,
really nice. So for those who haven't seen it, enjoy yourself for the next minute. This is a really nice video.
Oh, whoops, crash.
Okay, well, we're talking about crashes, what type of software do each of you use? So for example, Matt, or is it already up?
It's up. I think,
okay.
It's
I think we're good.
Until we cure ourselves of slavery.
Whether any of you or anyone else knows it, I know I need this. This amendment is that cure.
So Krishna, wonderful video.
And we're not the only ones who think so either.
Tell us what happened after the video.
That's Spielberg's letter. He handwrote a letter back to me. He saw it because I posted this as one of the far-flung correspondent pieces. And actually, how it got to him was Aneth White, one of the correspondents. She knew the makeup artist of Lincoln, Louis Bower. So she passed it on to Lewis, and she passed it on to Spielberg. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so he...
Oh, I noticed that the address and phone number are grayed out. Okay.
But you raise a really great point that it's as much about Krishna as it is about Steven. It's a reflection of the love of Spielberg's films in Krishna's eyes. And that kind of speaks for all of our work here. It's like the movies reflected in our eyes and us being able to speak through the movies, which is the title of this panel. And again, bringing it back to Roger, you know, you talk about a person who kind of was able to discover and express their genius through other people's work and make it their own. You know, his voice was realized through that. And I feel like in the same way we're sort of following in his footsteps, both in form and in spirit.
So I'm getting the impression from you that a film is not just what you see in the screen. The film is the whole communal experience, and you can't separate the audience or the author of the essay from the film. It is this whole unified, interconnected whole.
Yeah, absolutely.
Grace, yours is a little bit different. So you open up the festival we open up the festival with your wonderful movie, and we'll watch a few clips of it. Would you categorize your film as a video essay, or how would you categorize it?
Well, first of all, I feel a little bit inadequate to be on this panel. When Kevin first asked me, I was like, what am I doing here?
Mm-hmm.
I think these people, these wonderful people, some of who I call my friends, do something really special, which I personally don't feel I can do. And I think that's taking a piece of art, someone else's narrative, and bringing their own personal insights and feelings to it, but doing it in a way that in the process creates their own narrative. You know, by using some really sophisticated cinematic craftsmanship like editing and not just simply putting video clips together with narration and voiceover, and at the same time helping you to understand someone else's narrative. And I think that's something really special, and I've watched so many of these videos, and they've helped me in my own work, and especially making my first film. I mean, I've watched, you know, Dr. Borwell's constructive editing, I think, like, numerous times while editing my own film. So I'm just really happy to be here. And this is a clip. Kevin, is this the beginning of the film? Or?
Yeah,
it's the beginning. So it's the beginning of my first short film.
Thank you so much for that. Especially after watching Kevin's piece about Patrick's film, I've gotten a new dimension on Grace's film, looking at the depictions of our characters, especially because they're Asian, or as I like to call them, East Asian. But putting all of our conversations together, let's say I'm up late at night, it's 2 a.m., and I've watched 10 videos of kittens on YouTube. What does a video essay give me? Anyone, what would you say?
Are you naked?
I can't even answer that question.
As long as he stays behind the podium, we'll never know.
Yeah. So tell me, is it education? Is it passion? What are you giving me?
It's the same thing that you get out of reading any sort of criticism, ideally, which is... I've been, like I guess probably everybody, thinking a lot about Roger, and I have a daughter who's 15, who's a budding film student, and she just started really reading criticism, like in the last 6 months or so, and was, I think, maybe finally understanding what her dad does now. And she asked me after Roger died what made Roger's criticism different from other people's. And you know how kids sometimes will have a way of asking you a question that's so basic that it actually makes you think? And this is one of those moments. And what I told her was that what made Roger so popular was that he was, I think, over and above being a critic, he was a teacher. And Tilda Swinton, I think, used the word enthusiast. I think that's accurate, but I think a teacher and an enthusiast are one and the same. At least a teacher who excites people is an enthusiast. And the way that the teacher gets people to open their minds and see things in a new way and learn things that they didn't know before is by connecting the material with their emotions and their values. And every single review that Roger wrote started from the position of, what does this movie say? What are the values of this movie? And what emotions does this movie draw out of the viewer? And once you made that connection with the reader or with the viewer, in the case of these video essays, then you can move on from there and say, it's because it is cut in this way. It's because the shots, the repeated motifs, do this to you emotionally. Or the position of the camera expresses superiority to this character or inferiority to this character. Like, once you've got them with the values and the emotions, you can go anywhere you want to with it. And you know, that's a really valuable lesson to learn, and I think a lot of criticism neglects that. Like, either the critics are not interested in it, or they're not equipped to take that approach for whatever reason. But that was not true of Roger. And to bring it back to those pieces that he used to do with Gene Siskel, so many people learned about a world of cinema that they never would have explored before because those shows, and particularly those segments, were so exciting and fun. Like they made, you know, like I was a 12-year-old who wanted to go see My Dinner with Andre in the theater.
Yeah.
And my friends were talking about Conan the Barbarian and how they couldn't wait to see Conan the Barbarian. And I'm like, you know, I've seen My Dinner with Andre twice now. You guys should go. It's about these two middle-aged guys having dinner. You'd love it. And that was because of Roger's enthusiasm. Like he would not shut up about My Dinner with Andre. Him and Siskel both. It was like every week they'd be reviewing, you know, a werewolf movie, and it's like, but it's no My Dinner with Andre. You know, and if you could, and if you have that kind of enthusiasm, you can get people to go anywhere. And I think a lot of these video essays, some of them are purely self-expressive, in the sense that they're about getting you to see the movie through the eyes of the filmmaker, and a lot of good criticism does that too. But they're also analytical, and I think the ones that are the most effective that really connect with people online do both of those things.
Mm-hmm. So what we're seeing here with all of your works, what we're seeing here is not only that movies should be valued, but here is why you should value this movie. Here is why you should give your time to this movie, and it'll make your life experience better. Dr. Borden, were you about to?
Yeah, I wanted to just add something. I think there's another, in terms of a film appreciation and increasing knowledge of cinema, I think these are just wonderful things, and it's really gratifying to someone my age who started teaching film in the early 70s to see how a popular show like Gene and Rogers, but also the kind of individual pathways these people have taken towards cinema have kind of converged on what's essentially a new movement in filmmaking. I would also add this, and this may not be so evident because they're all so modest. I think this trend is a really important contribution to public culture, and for this reason. When I was coming up, it was very difficult to use extracts from films for educational purposes. It was mechanically, technically difficult because I started teaching before there was video. So I would show clips from 16mm films and eventually they would be damaged or worn and so forth. When video comes along, and well before the internet really became what it is, you were using these rather crappy clips in class. And there was already a problem with some people being allowed to use those clips for educational purposes. Well, what has become I regard these people as champions of fair use, because as you know, what the studios and other corporations have done is really commandeered fair use to the point where particularly big cinematic properties like the Star Wars franchise would forbid fans from including clips from the film on websites, remaking portions of the film, inserting things, pop-up commentary, all that stuff. Lucas may have been a very good filmmaker early on. I agree with Mr. Boone, but nevertheless, he started and reinforced a movement that was started by Disney principally to shut down any sort of discussion, a public discussion of art, of that sort of art. And these guys just went ahead and did it. Mm-hmm. And I mean, they just did it. I don't think they asked permission from anybody. They just took the clips, took the soundtracks, and did it. And what I see today is a real softening of that hard line of the corporations. A flashpoint for this, I think, and it's a film that stirs a lot of passion, I suspect, on this panel, is Room 237. I think hardcore copyright is gone after Room 237.
Tell us about the movie. What is this movie?
Well, it's a film about a range of interpretations that The Shining has had. Some of them seem sort of plausible. Some strike people as preposterous or just plain nuts. And the thing is that it's illustrated by probably what might be a quarter of the running time in total of The Shining. Extracts, run back and forth, blow-ups, a dissection of the movie, sometimes, as I say, along eccentric lines, I suppose. But what's fascinating at the level of, as I say, public culture, is that it's being done. It's just out there. So there's a way in which what they're doing, I won't call it subversive or guerrilla filmmaking necessarily, but they're just going ahead and saying, look, this belongs to all of us. At a certain point, when this comes out, the artist has put it out there for discussion, let's discuss it. And we need to discuss it in a rigorous and thoughtful and engaging way. We need to extract from it. We need to show you what we're talking about. And they just went ahead and did it. And I think they've really struck a blow for civic culture.
So I'm getting this idea that, all right, on the one hand, you have the artist or more likely the corporation who says, we own the product.
Right.
And then we have the video essayists who are saying, this is art. So Kevin, tell us about some of the problems you've run into.
Oh yeah, I've had my YouTube account shut down. I've had my Vimeo account shut down. And then through, you know, both with YouTube, it was like a publicity campaign or public outcry campaign waged on my behalf, which then led YouTube to reinstate the account, which was great. And actually it led to some, I guess, legitimate work, because then a couple of film companies said, hey, you know, we think your work is great. Why don't you make video essays for us and we'll pay you. And stuff. But then, you know, that leads to these interesting kind of ethical issues where people were asking me, well, like, do you like their movies? You know, because what happens if you don't like a movie? And you and David, you bring up, you know, Room 237, which I agree really does break new ground in terms of, you know, what is fair use? How much footage can someone use to make basically what is a feature-length film? But we don't actually know the facts as to what was the agreement, if any, that the distributor, the artist, and Warner Brothers, who owns The Shining, made with each other. And frankly, I think Warner Brothers would be idiots if they didn't let this film, you know, see the light of day, because it's basically, in my opinion, it's a feature-length commercial for The Shining, and it basically adds to the aura of The Shining and makes people want to see it. What happens if you want to, you know, go against a George Lucas or a Spielberg and just, you know, what if, you know, God forbid, but what if Krishna had made, you know, that video to show all the kind of shortcomings in Steven Spielberg's filmmaking? You know, so the freedom of speech, the freedom of expression. Yeah, Krishna's ducking under the table.
He might get not a handwritten letter, but a type letter.
Well, all I'm saying, I agree with you, and we appreciate, I think, because you were the point man on that for a long time. But I think all I'm saying is that it's a real step forward. It's to bring this out for public discussion. We've always said, whenever we've done extracts, even in the old days when I would put in stills from Hollywood movies in books, people would say, well, you know what, this is kind of an advertisement for the film. It at least makes people aware of it and so on. And so you really shouldn't object. And the studios would say, we don't care. We're going to object because we own this. And you don't. And that was a criticism, of course, that Siskel and Ebert got, that they were, from some sides, people were saying that they were an extension of the advertising campaign for the film. I disagree with that. But I think there's a point at which there's always that question of to what extent are you enhancing the value of the product. But in a way, that's what criticism always does. I mean, you read a commentary on a painting, you say, I think I'd like to see that painting. You know?
Well, yeah, and a lot of times a pan will make me, if it's depending on who the pan is coming from, will actually make me more excited to see the film. If I know, like, this person hated it, it's got to be good.
Krishna, you were making a comment.
Another thing that I say to my students is, I went to medical school 4 years before I became a film critic. I decided that I wanted to be rich, and one of the things that I learned from medical school is that a lot of the advancements especially when you're studying something so complex as the brain, is you discover things how the brain works through cases where it went wrong. So you can use a bad film to illustrate important points about filmmaking.
Absolutely.
So constantly I would take a film that I don't like and show that it doesn't work because of that and that. And as soon as we want to see that film, not because, oh, if that guy says it's bad, it must be good, but because, oh, I will learn something from that bad movie.
Exactly.
And I think it's educational too.
Krishna, you're making a point.
Yeah, I actually got a copyright notice from YouTube about the music.
You got a letter from Steven Spielberg saying this is wonderful, and YouTube said copyright violation.
You can't use the music.
I actually had something similar to that happen to me in 2009. I did a video essay with a writer from the Elle magazine, analyzing the certain motifs in the films of Catherine Bigelow, who at the time had just made The Hurt Locker. And The Hurt Locker was in theaters, and they had electronic press kits available online with clips, but the clips were chopped up. They were chopped up, they were designed to be shown on like Good Morning America or whatever, and I wanted the actual movie to draw from. So I went to Chinatown and bought a DVD on the street and ripped it.
This is not an endorsement.
And as it happened, I interviewed Catherine Bigelow on the phone for a different reason at the week that I was working on that, and I thought, well, why don't I just tell her what I'm doing? And I said, by the way, I'm working on a video essay analyzing key motifs in your films. She said, that's so exciting and flattering. I can't wait to see it. She said, how did you get footage from the Hurt Locker? And I said, I bought a DVD in Chinatown. And she said, awesome. She was really excited. Like, you know, not, it wasn't like, will you stay on the line while I put my lawyer on? She was, the director of the movie was excited about it. A month later, it was taken down by YouTube.
Uh-huh. Well, here's an amateur version of that. A few years ago, my girlfriend I was living with, she decided she was going to make a little fan tribute to Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind and upload it to YouTube. So that was cool. She was into that kind of thing. And I got a letter in the mail one day from the cable company, which sent me a copy of an internet log from Universal saying that, you know, basically we saw you downloading a copy of Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, and here's when you did it. And if you don't stop doing this, you're gonna, you know, we have to sever our ties with you, essentially.
So this is the cable company saying.
This is the cable company saying, right. Universal got to us, and you know, right. You're in trouble if you keep doing this. No more cable for you. You know, so I said, you know, oh man, we gotta stop this, you know. And you know, she went ahead, I don't know remember the timeline, but she essentially edited the thing, uploaded it to her channel, and I think for a moment there was like a dispute with YouTube, and they got into, this was around the time when they got into this practice of reviewing it and seeing if it has any kind of promotional value, and they decided it was cool and it stayed up. So on one end we're being threatened, but on the other end I guess somebody or something evaluated the video and saw that it had some sort of, it was harmless in some way.
Well, but a lot of this is interest. Automated.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. So, right, there was this super viral video that a colleague of Madnar's, Nelson Carvajal, a young, really enthusiastic filmmaker and video essayist,
from Chicago,
he made a 4-minute video with clips of every single Oscar Best Picture winner from 1927 to 2012. And so this was picked up on USA Today, The Atlantic, all of these blogs saying, wow, now you can watch all, you know, 75 Oscar winners in 4 minutes. You know, it went super viral. I mean, you couldn't ask for a better promotional kind of vehicle for the Oscars. And then the video was taken down from his Vimeo account because of a dispute by Disney. And so, you know, Nelson went to us and said, why would Disney, you know, pick a fight with me? Like, I'm, you know, and Matt made a great point. It's like, they probably didn't even see the video. They probably just had some sort of automated content detector that looks at screen captures of movie clips and detected it in the video, and you know, that set off an alarm bell.
And they automatically sent an email to YouTube or Vimeo or whoever the service is. And there's a thing, you know, just to backtrack a little bit in this concept of fair use and copyright, there's an aspect of this called notice and takedown, and this was kind of a compromise struck between the government and the big companies that own these movies, and music and television shows and anything else that's copyrighted, which is that any company that was a party to uploading something without authorization, if they were notified by the copyright holder, hey, this was not authorized, they have to take it down. And then they'll figure out later if there was a legitimate reason for taking that footage, that song, whatever.
Yeah, this brings to mind, you know, one of Roger's favorite movies is Citizen Kane, and there's this great line that Kane says to Jed Leland, here's to love in my terms. They're the only terms that anyone ever knows. They're their own terms. And this is basically what's come to with corporate media and the viewer, fan, slash consumer, where, like, you know, they take from our wallets, they have our eyeballs, and now it's like they want to control our minds in the sense that we can't express our own opinions and thoughts on this.
One moment really quickly. We're going to start opening up the floor up for questions. And I want to say that when we began the conversation, I thought this was going to be a discussion about how much we love movies. We love movies so much that we start editing essays about them. Now it's turned into this huge matter of social justice against the machines. Now the government's part of this. And I don't know, is there like a photo of Che Guevara up here somewhere? Okay, I have a question, sir.
Yes, my question builds on this these most recent comments about the takedown, et cetera. A lot of that you describe as being essentially automated. And my question is, is there any step in the way where, or along the way, where a human being actually thinks about something? Or is the whole process automated and the machinery sends out the letter and no human being is ever involved?
Well, human beings are involved because when a filmmaker receives a notice like this, it's guilty until proven innocent is the way it works. And a lot of filmmakers don't know that you can appeal this, and you can file what's called a counter notice, which is YouTube gets a notice from, say, Disney saying, hey, this isn't authorized, take it down. They have to take it down. It's the law. And then the filmmaker finds out about it, and they email YouTube and say, hey, I have a legitimate reason for using that footage. It falls under one of these areas of fair use: criticism, commentary, journalism, education, or satire parody. I think those are the five. And I don't know if the law has changed since I ran into this issue, but they have to ultimately serve you. They have to serve you and say, you have broken the law. You have used our property illegally. Otherwise, if they don't do that, and I think they have 2 weeks to do it, they have to put the video back up. Mm-hmm. But the way that YouTube and Vimeo and other uploaders get around this is simply by just ignoring the counter notice. And the companies ignore the counter notice, or they just say they never received it or whatever. So in a way, you kind of have no appeal. I had some videos taken down that were later put back up when I filed a counter notice, but a lot of people, it's sort of old Soviet Union way of dealing with the problem, which is just, you know, I filed my counter notice and like nobody ever read it, you know, or they round filed it or whatever.
But what I don't understand is when we were uploading a video to YouTube, for instance, there is this screen when they ask you if you're using other people's material and why you were using them. And so when you're uploading it, you explain that it's fair use because of this and that. It doesn't, so it's just for show, that screen?
They don't, the copyright holder doesn't, and by copyright holder I mean the spam bot that is working for the copyright holder. Sometimes they're scouring the internet and they're looking for what are called digital watermarks in the mm-hmm. footage, which are embedded in there specifically to trigger these notices. And sometimes they catch you and sometimes they don't. It's some matter of algorithm. I don't entirely understand it. I don't understand why a particular video that I made that used footage from some MGM musicals was taken down, where there are the entire film that I took that clip from is still on YouTube. Mm-hmm. I don't understand
it. Sure. Yeah.
It just seems like it's random.
Well, one thing to think about is I think if people are going to use extracts, they have to be maybe a little more selective about how they use the extracts mm-hmm. because I've only used still images except where I got permission from the distributors. And even in the one that you saw the clip of, Criterion gave us permission to use certain extracts for other things, but those are behind a wall. This one, I asked Criterion because I wanted to use 1 minute of Breslin's Pickpocket, and they said, okay, you have our permission to use 1 minute Pickpocket that's generally available to anybody in the world if they want to download that video. And when I showed it to them and said, maybe you want to put this on your site, they said, I don't know, you have all those pictures from other movies. And I said, but they're just pictures, they're just frames, you know, from other movies. They said, you can do it, but we can't.
Well, and it's important to point out that that the use of this footage is not in and of itself automatically illegal and may not, in fact, be legally problematic. It's a question of who's going to sue you.
It's all about people. Publishers are afraid of suits from Disney, even if they're perfectly within their rights to publish those frames, because mm-hmm. they don't want to be sued by Disney. And the same with us. I mean, I think these people don't. That what Vimeo and YouTube are saying is, we don't want to hear from Universal. Because you're actually in the right legally, but the mishigas of dealing with Universal is not worth it.
Well, that's why Room 237 is such an interesting test case, right. And there are other projects that are like, a lot of the fan-made Star Wars stuff, I think, is also mm-hmm. interesting for this reason. And to my knowledge, I can't think of any cases that have actually gone to trial. And the reason that they haven't actually gone to trial is the person who is being told, you use this footage without authorization, we want you to take it down. They do it because they don't have the money or the time to fight it. And that's what these companies are banking on. And if you actually push them, if you actually stand your ground, and if you have somebody in your corner who's a copyright lawyer or maybe somebody who can pay for a lawyer, if they did go to court, it would set a precedent.
That's right.
And I think that's why, you know, to answer one of your questions from earlier, Warner Brothers
That's why I think if they did reach an accommodation right. with the makers of 237, or in fact, maybe they just decided to pretend it didn't exist. Like, we don't, they may have done that.
And there are other clips from other films of 237.
Yeah. Right. That aren't cited. Because if they had gone to court over it, they would have lost, and it would have set a precedent that yep. every other entertainment company would have had to abide by, and none of them want that.
Mm-hmm. While we're waiting for more questions. Oh, you have another question, sir.
Yeah, excellent forensic discussion. Thank you. Someone please remind me of the precise name of that law.
Well, there's the Digital Millennium Copyright Act.
The Digital Millennium Copyright Act. Yeah. A question if while we're waiting for more. Patrick and Grace, both of you are on this panel with original films in this whole festival. How would you react if one day after watching babies giggling on YouTube, you saw your film in a video essay being lambasted? What would you do? I don't think it's possible because your films are so wonderful, but let's say you have someone who has an axe to grind. What would you do?
That's a good question. And I don't know that I would not have an automatic response. And I think that automation kills like this discussion of what is, I don't think it's a one or the other thing. There is something that is reasonable and wonderful, and there's situations that may be a little extreme. I worry sometimes when the quality of what I've made is compromised. Mm-hmm. You know, if it's a really bad video, if it's distorted sound, but some of that you have to let go of just because that gets compromised in movie theaters too. I think it depends on the quality of the conversation. I doubt I'd have a problem with it. I have more, but I also have from the other side a YouTube automation story too, is when I uploaded my first video to YouTube, I got this automatic message that said, "We have detected your video has bad lighting. Would you like us to fix this?"
Wow.
And I think that is problematic and that everything's kind of pulling you to this narrower
it's kind of helpful
conversation.
Actually.
I can't even explain why, but that freaks me out more than anything that anyone has said today.
How about bad grammar? How about spelling?
It's just you two saying you suck.
You guys have never had this experience. I feel
very often. But they should include a notice that you are naked in this picture.
Yeah, the Pablo clause. Yes, sir.
Thank you. David, I've been thinking about your introduction quite a bit, and Matt, your wonderful talk about Roger's criticism, and made me realize how he brought in elements of the personal essay into that criticism in some important ways. He developed it much more in the blog later on. Is it possible for this form to bring the personal essay into video? I think Grace's wonderful film does this in a certain way, outside of criticism, not fiction, not quite documentary, but that has a voice and brings it to life in video.
I'm sorry.
I think Stevens does.
The answer is yes. You can do anything you can do in a written essay, in a written form. You can do it in video form. It's just by other means. And I'm excited by the possibilities. And we're going to see some amazing things, I think, where people bring more of themselves into this stuff. And try to integrate, try to just really mash up genres and incorporate more of themselves, more of their life, more of their, just more interaction between what's up there and what's in their lives. That's what it's there for. And it's out there. I mean, these guys are geniuses and they're doing amazing work. But rest assured, there's others out there that we don't even know about yet that are doing it from Krishna's age on up, so yes, that's my firm answer, that these possibilities exist, and in their work you see some of it. You definitely see some of
Sheila. What do you see as the future?
Well, I loved, I started watching Jim Emerson's or reading his site where he would break down shots and everyone would, sequences and the whole Dark Knight where everyone just went insane because he was basically saying why certain sequences did not work for him due to all kinds of confusion. And that was I've been watching, movies since I was a kid, obviously. But there was something about his eye. I loved his video essay about falling and the perspective of, different shots of people falling and landing. And it's very simply done. It's he shows the shots, he tells you what you're gonna see. There's two people, there's a landing, there's a this, that. And I could watch those deep into the night by myself. I mean, I just get, I think they're fascinating and great educational tools, and also just enthusiastic about the art of filmmaking when it works and when it doesn't work, as we mentioned. Well, it's really interesting.
That's actually a good example of what Omer asked about, because it's a very critical essay on the Dark Knight. I mean, if Nolan
really
had
is.
If Nolan had his choice, he probably wouldn't prefer it to be up there. Yet it still sits up there, as far as I know.
Yeah.
I don't understand why it's still up there, honestly. I mean, because it's attacking one of the most popular movies ever made.
Yep. Jim is that good.
Maybe the spam bot just missed it.
It makes the case.
Jim is that good. Jim should be here. He really should. Yeah.
Yeah, so one thing that I found is interesting is that a number of these videos that we've been speaking about have gone viral. And I think what they do speak to is the fact that not only do we love movies, not only do we love talking about movies as a global audience, we even just love watching clips of movies. I mean, Grace, like, what? Imagine 10 years from now, somebody named Kevin Lee makes a video of Grace Wang's clips. As a filmmaker, what does that do for you?
That's going to be the title, Grace Wang's Clips.
Grace Wang's Clips. Not to be confused with Grace Wang's hair and style. Anyway, keep going.
Well, I think anything made by Kevin Lee, I probably will have no problem with, because he's just, I think, amazing at what he's doing. I think I agree with Patrick. I think it really depends on the work. I think for me, what I respond to personally and when I was writing about films professionally was the presence of a personal voice. I think whatever you do, whether it's a video essayist or whether it's a filmmaker, if you have a personal voice and if you are able to convey that to the audience in a sincere way, an honest way, then I think there's truth in that, and I think that should be embraced. So for me, I think if the work is honest and it's personal, I have no problem with it.
Okay, 20 years from now, YouTube will have a trillion videos. Where do you see the next step is, going from print to video essay? Look into the future. I mean, will the machines also make video essays? Is this what's gonna happen?
That is kind of happening, isn't it? When you have websites like movieclips.com, where they're basically the system, as it were. Sorry, I keep vilifying the system, but
it's
sort of something in my DNA. it's offering you all these clips that you can play with. And so again, it's love on our terms. And it's sort of co-opting all of this fan-generated creative activity and finding ways to incorporate it into the system, and then maybe find a way to monetize, which is really what it all comes down to.
So we will see monetization. Were you about to make a point too?
Yeah, I was kind of prepared to say certain things on this panel, and then I saw Kevin's video essay, which is really only available on the DVD for In the Family, and it's an incredibly brilliant video essay about In the Family, and it works hand in hand with that film. And In the Family is just an incredible classic that's gonna be around forever. And I'm given to extreme statements. And here comes one.
Brace yourself.
In the Family basically solves America's problems.
Keystone Pipeline?
Everything.
That's a DVD box blurb if I ever heard one.
It's yours. And then Kevin's video tells you how it does it. And it tells you what the problem is, what's wrong with this. It basically tells you, it doesn't explicitly tell us this, it has nothing to do with this, but for instance, the CEO of the Nestle Corporation recently talking about how water isn't a human right, you know, and how genetically modified foods are just basically the future, get over it. You know, it's this mentality of people in power in people in corporations. I'm not trying to turn them all into, villains with capes, because they're human beings like anybody else, but it's this way of thinking about the world and thinking about time and relationships and all that kind of stuff that's going to determine our future or not. And that video essay, which talks about how we relate to time and space, how we relate to each other, using Patrick's film as a prism for that, is incredibly important. And it totally like derailed anything I had to say, because it speaks for me in terms of what this is really all about. What this is, when you pare everything down, all this, it's wonderful to analyze sequences and things. It's fun.
Yeah.
But we're in a real crisis, and we're culturally, it's almost like an environmental disaster that we're going through now. And we need to slow down, see each other a little bit better, and view films the way we view films here at Ebertfest, generally speaking, which is with more regard and more patience and more more clarity, I think. And I'm rambling right now, but so, I think some of that makes sense.
I really connect to what you're saying, because I think it connects to what all of us are doing, which is having an intimate and personally invested relationship with art, with films, and with other people. And this is our vehicle for communicating with that. And
Don't be consumers.
That's exactly the point, where you're no longer someone who's shelling like 10, 20 bucks for every movie and just watching it and okay, bring on the next one, and every week it's the same ritual. You're actually stopping to think and process what you are watching and coming to a more enriched relationship with it.
Metaphors exist.
Yeah.
That's what movies are. They're metaphors. They exist. They have impact on us. They affect our emotions. They shape our values. They shape our worldview. They make it possible for other people to deceive and manipulate us if they're the wrong kind of messages. And every kind of movie does it. Every kind of movie does it. And the ones that think they're good are doing it. And the ones that know they're bad are doing it. And the only way to sort of have any kind of power as an audience member is to look more closely and then talk about what we saw.
Yeah. And you relate this, you know, because I was at this conference talking about how YouTube monitors and you know, manages the content that goes through its doors. And they actually, I saw this video that one of these content detecting agencies produced to basically show the studios what they're doing on their behalf. And it was this crazy like flash animation where, you know, video clips are going through this sort of like Charlie Chaplin Modern Times like assembly line. And then there are like these eyes that are like scanning it. And the voiceover goes, imagine 60 million eyes watching, actually 6,000 pairs of eyes watching 60 million clips every minute. This is what we've assembled. And to kind of even imagine what that would be like in reality is just frightening. You know, and it's their way of kind of creating a concrete, you know, kind of physical, description of what they're doing. And it's completely, I feel like it's completely different from what we're doing, just sitting at our
computer. Well, that's the boogeyman. It's the boogeyman.
So, all right, so this conversation's taking an even stranger turn here. So now we have a call to action here. We've gone from wonderful movies, here's what I like about movies, to Man Against the Machine, to the U.S. Constitution should be replaced by In the Family.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, so now give us prescriptions for saving the world. What should we do? Krishna, what should we do to prevent the world from being overtaken by the machines? You are our savior. Tell us, what do we need to do?
Savior, he directed In the Family.
Okay.
I don't know, I think, okay, seriously, it's about copyright, right? So,
yeah.
I don't know, that's a loaded question.
Okay, so because the machines are watching right now, you can't share the answers.
Yeah.
I can answer for him.
Please,
just keep creating, keep using these tools to really find who you are and what you have to say, and to really see. It's people are doing what needs to be done. You know, animate these machines in a human way. And stop thinking so much about how much money you're leaking while you're doing that. That's what these corporations do. And that's what all these systems are about. It's about, oh, let's minimize how much money we're leaking. Let's keep this thing going. Let's reduce shrinkage. You know, it's just like a retail thing. So just keep making stuff, man, and making real stuff.
Well, I think what connects the first part of this discussion to this last part is that movies, there is a perception, and we all, I think, have absorbed it to some degree, that the movies are theirs. Theirs meaning the people who made them, and they are. And there are certain inalienable rights that artists have, and the company that puts up money to make the artist's work also has rights. But in the end, movies are ours. They're ours in the way that a painting or a symphony or a novel becomes ours. It becomes a part of the collective culture. And we have personal relationships with this culture, and we have a right to talk about it, even if it's something as simple as is trying to communicate the intense joy that we feel when we watch the films of Steven Spielberg, or something that's a little more analytical or explicitly political, talking about the values expressed in a movie and how they might be bad, you know. But it's all part of the same continuum, I think. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. So ultimately, it's a battle for beauty. It's a battle for keeping our humanity, and then the solution here is to keep expressing our humanity, whether it's on the big screen, the little screen, the feature film, or the video essay. And so the cure is to keep creating and keep expressing. And that was what keeps the conversation going, and that's what keeps us growing. So wonderful discussion. Took directions I did not expect. Thank you very much. Krishna, Grace, Patrick, Pablo, Matt, Kevin.
Hold on a minute, may I ask?
And Dr. Bordell. Oh, another question.
My dad and I get to go to 2 film festivals a year. Okay. The other one is in Indianapolis. It's called the Heartland Film Festival.
Yes.
1 year, their theme was the movies you watch can change the way you see. And I think you all
Beautiful.
Are saying yeah. that, and thank you, and keep doing it.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, that's a wrap. And also, we miss Mike Mirasol, whose essay appears at the beginning of every screen. Mike, you're with us. Jim Emerson, you're also with us, as well as the rest of the far-flung correspondents. Thank you very much. Have a great day, everyone. Yeah.